this is what I know about it. But then you can say, maybe my state is coupled somehow to the environment. And the environment could be the whole universe, could be anything. And then we can say that I have a wave function, I'll write it like that, of the system plus environment, which describes the whole world, let's say the universe. But I don't have access to that. I'm locally sitting here in Istanbul, all what I can see is what here. So I can measure only here. So the information that is available to me is only here, only on my system. Now if this is what's available to me, I can't tell you if the universe is a pure state or not. There is no way I can do that. There's no way I can infer from measurements on my system, you can say it's knowledge of my system is described by this case. So in this case, the universe is pure in this example. It's described by a wave function. You can say a pure state has this property. It's a projection operator. That, the operators. The universe is pure, but if I look at my system, means I have to trace over the universe. This is not pure, or it doesn't have to be. So, in a way, when von Neumann realized that if the universe is pure, and I'm looking only at the subsystem, you have a problem, or
no? No. We couldn't see the...
What?
This trace over B seems to be like a bracket or something.
This?
Yeah. It's just the trace over the density matrix.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, I'll just give a way to think about this from a probability point of view. So, what von Neumann reasoned that even if the universe is pure, my subsystem will always be, not always, but in most cases will be mixed, except for special cases which will reach to that. Which means, if this is true, and if I want to base a theory on local observation, I can't do that on wave functions. So that's why our state is always going to be considered by a density operator. Now just to elaborate what I'm doing here, basically this is completely analogous to probability theory when we look at these, what's happening here, this relation between this and this. You can say that I can think about a joint probability. I, let's say the system J is the bath. So this is a joint probability distribution. If I sum on IJ, it will be 1. Now if I want to know what's the marginal probability, the probability of my system being in the state I, what I have to do is sum over J on the joint probability. So this expression is basically exactly the same idea. I tracing over the bath means sum over the bath degrees of freedom, reducing it to the state of the system, and getting, you could call this the marginal density operator of the system only, which I traced over the bath. So, this, as I said, will be our basic construction. So, I know that in undergraduate courses of quantum mechanics, people talk about wave functions, and the usual expression for an observable talk about wave functions, if we want to know what's the expectation value of an observable, we write it psi operator psi, which we understand that this is a Hermitian operator, and this is our expectation value. So this is, you could call it, I would call this is the undergraduate version of quantum mechanics. Now we're in a graduate version of quantum mechanics. The correct expression, which generalizes this expression here, is that this is, I would call it, the scalar product between two operators. And I write it as a scalar product like that, which is also, we call it trace, this Hermitian operator of S times the Hermitian operator, which it brings me to something that will simplify our understanding. In a way, it's one hand abstract, on the other hand very simple. If I want to know what's the probability of getting some outcome out of an experiment, all what I have to do is do a scalar product between two objects. Now, since these are, if we want to think about these mathematically, they're matrices, so what we have to do is define scalar product between matrices, and this is to have the axioms of scalar products, this is a trace operation. This is the way you can interpret this. Okay, so now, this is, here I'll use another color. This will be our first axiom of our quantum mechanics that I need to develop my theory, that an observable is a scalar product between the state of the system and the operator we want to measure. So there are two things. In quantum mechanics, the outcome depends on what you measure. So this comes here. And this describes the state of the system. So we made, I call this a static axiom of quantum mechanics. We made everything very concise. So I don't think I can teach quantum mechanics in 10 minutes, but I hope I have a common language that what I'll continue later, you'll be able to. So this is the first thing I'm going to use. And the second thing I need now is dynamics. So I want to know how my state changes with time. So how to relate this to the density operator at time zero. So this is what I want to know how to do. And what, again, von Neumann tells us that this we can do by unitary operator. So we take our state, which is here, which this is our initial state, apply unitary operator on it, on both sides, and get the state at time t. So, how does, you can say, how do we get, and this has index of time. So this comes from the idea that evolution is a group, and this unitary operation has to obey group properties of time evolution. So you see, time is, in this theory is continuous, and it evolves, and it evolves in a group kind of structure, which means that if no time happened, nothing happened. And we can always continue our evolution. So we can stop and continue from there on, and this idea of a group will become important when I talk about open quantum systems. So we can go, and we also know that in mechanics is reversible in time, so every operation I go forward in time, I should be able to do it backwards in time. So it means if I have u of t, u of minus t is nothing. So if I go forward, I go backward, I should get to the same place. And you can say this is a definition of mechanics. And in a minute I'll throw that this property away, but I'll leave this kind of group structure. So when we have this idea of a group structure, we say, okay, how can I generate a unitary operation? So you can say, you need some mathematics, and luckily von Neumann knew a little bit. So what does he say? He says that if we want to generate this u of t, you can always write it as e to the power of minus I divided by h bar, some Hermitian operator times t. So if this is Hermitian, this is unitary. So what I did here, I generated, this is called the generator, which generates this group property. So this is a generator of the evolution. So h generates my evolution u, and which I can write it like that, and out of this, I can continue this a little bit. This is ht. And the only thing I said about this h is it's Hermitian, or and we call it a Hamiltonian. That's customary. So this is rho of t. And now if I take the time derivative of that, I get this equation, which is called the Liouville von Neumann equation of motion of my state. So I started from an integral form of the structure of events, flow of time, and I got a differential equation. Now, usually in teaching go opposite. Sometimes people say this is an axiom, but this is, you could say, goes back to when Newton and Apple hit his head and he came out with F equals MA. It took physics 100 years through Hamilton and Lagrange to try to formulate it. What happened when this apple hit Newton's head to try to make rational? Because if you write a differential equation as an axiom, what does it mean? It's hard. This is easier to understand. This group structure makes, I would say, mentality much more sense than to say, okay, this is my equation. So what I did, if you take this, take the time derivative, you get the equation of motion, which is called the Liouville von Neumann equation of motion. So this is the group structure. This is the evolution which we'll use for the universe. So we'll use this type of evolution all the time. And immediately, the consequence that you see here out of this type of evolution, that if this is an operator, this evolution doesn't change the eigenvalues of this operator. Because if I take this and diagonalize it, I do it with a unitary operator, because this is Hermitian. So I add another unitary operator. So I don't change the eigenvalues. So this is a very important property that we'll use later, that the eigenvalues of the evolution of the state of the system are not changed by unitary evolution. So we'll see that this gives a consequence that under unitary evolution, entropy is conserved, which is would give us a direction towards the second law of thermodynamics. So this is a preview why I need this expression, that unitary operators don't change eigenvalues. I can write it if you don't get it immediately. If I have an operator and I use S as dagger and bring it to a diagonal form, this is, let's say, would be rho of 0, and then I have rho of t, which is equal to u rho of 0 u dagger. And if I want to diagonalize this, I know how to do that. I just have to untangle this, so I can diagonalize, get, let's call it d of t. So what I'll do, I'll take rho of t and do the opposite, bring it back. So I changed the dagger from here, so I went backwards in time, and then I'll put s and s dagger, and I can say I diagonalized it by a new matrix, let's call it R, which is s times u dagger. So what I showed you, or a sketch of a proof that unitary operation don't change eigenvalues of my density operator. So you can say it has many consequences, since the diagonal elements of our density operator are probabilities, as I said before. Probabilities conserved by unitary operator. Not only the probabilities conserved, each element in the is conserved. So unitary operations or evolution keeps the probabilities, or you can say the diagonal elements, the eigenvalues of my density operator. So this is, again, a very important consequence of my evolution. Okay, before we go on, we need the conjugate equation. And in order to do that, I'll do, again, a very simple exercise. I'll take this expression, and this is what is important for us. And as I said, if I want to know at the time t, I'll put the index here. It's my density operator at time t times my operator. But this I can write as u, index time t is here, this would be 0, times my operator. But now, and the scalar product is here, but now this is trace u now I use a mathematical property of the trace that I can move this over here. A trace is invariant to reordering. And I get this expression. So this is t. So how can I interpret this equation? So this is the same thing. This is expectation value of my operator at future time. So here, I changed the state of my system to be in future time, and I left my operator the same. What did I do here? My state stayed at 0, but I moved my operator. So this is, you can say, equivalent that either I walk and my frame of reference is moving, so this is Heisenberg picture, or I'm static, and the universe moves before my eyes. So these, in quantum mechanics, these two viewpoints are equivalent. This is what says here. So if we take this, we can see the evolution of the operator is opposite in time than the evolution of my state. So if my state moves forward in time, you can see my operator moves backwards in time. And if I want to write this as a differential equation, this would be Heisenberg. So the sign of time here changes. I'll get this part here. which is we call the Heisenberg equation of motion. And to make this complete, I'll make this a full derivative here. And I'll add here, which Landau did, an explicit time dependent of my operator. Why do I add this thing? We'll see we'll need that. Because in many cases, I want to define my operator itself as time dependent for some reasons. So my Hamiltonian has time dependence. So then, this is a total change in my operator, and this would be the evolution of my operator from the generator, from the Hamiltonian, and this would be the explicit time dependence. So I think now we completed unitary quantum mechanics, all what I need this axiom here, which is a static axiom of quantum mechanics. You can see that we can call this a dynamical axiom of quantum mechanics, which leads to two equivalent equations. Either this, which is called the Liouville von Neumann equation, or this equation, which we call the Heisenberg equation of motion.
Sir, is this I or T?
I. This is I. So what's important, you can see this sign here. Maybe I'll put it in another color. This moves forward in time, and the convention that this is sign here is minus, and this moves backwards in time, and the convention is a plus sign here. And you can see the same sign appears here in the definition of the unitary, and we can, this is a generator. So this is a generator of the unitary group that describes evolution. This is how we call it. And you can say this is forward in time and backwards in time. We reverse the sign here. We have plus, and we have this nice group structure. Okay, so this, in a way, I hope you, okay, people who know, I didn't say anything new, and if it's new to you, you'll have to talk to your friends and try to settle this and digest it, maybe on coffee. But in a way, this is enough, which looks very simple, to get a whole theory that we call quantum mechanical or thermodynamic resource theory. It's all based on what's written here. Not much beyond. You can have all kinds of tools, all kinds of things, and we can do it. Okay, so now I want to get to what's called quantum open systems. This is my task. So I'll clear this. So I have a structure, my system. Okay, it's not good. I'll make my system red and the bath blue. So what did I say? I have a composite world. I have part that I call system, what we have in this room, and the outer world that maybe today we don't want to think about, but that it exists. So this is our situation. So now, as we said, we have our system, combined system and bath, and we want to know how this evolves at time t. We can say, we can write it, this is what I took from what I told you before. But now, we have to think about the generator. Who generates this motion? So now, in order to do that, I have to define my generators or my Hamiltonians. So what do I have here in this simple structure? I can say I have a Hamiltonian of the system. I have a Hamiltonian of the bath. And I have this, which is my interface. Now, in thermodynamics, the interface is maybe the most important part of thermodynamics, the partition between system and bath. So we have different types of partition, let's say isothermal, allows heat to go through, allows particles. And now we want to write this in quantum mechanical terms, so I do it. I say I have a Hamiltonian of an interface. Later I can play tricks. I can say that this is in some sense much smaller than this or something like that. But at this point I don't have to say anything. I just have to partition my Hamiltonian like that. And you can say that my unitary evolution, this would be the total Hamiltonian, would be e to the power of minus I hs plus hb plus hsb t. So my evolution is generated by three generators. The one of my system, the one of the bath, and the one was my of both. So this is the game. These are the rules that we're going to follow. And now we know that the whole universe of system and bath evolve according to unitary operations. But now we want something that's more concrete. We want to know what is the evolution of our system without really being more explicit about the bath, because we really don't have access to the outer world. You barely see through a window. And so we want to use the minimum information on the outer world and still get some kind of evolution on my system. So this where the theory of quantum open systems comes. And I want to generate some type of equations of motion which tells me how my system evolves. Now here you have to do certain assumptions which I'll use. And we'll also discuss them, because if you put assumptions, you always put restrictions on your thinking. So what is the assumptions that they need? First of all, a very strong assumption that is this one. In words, and I'll give an example in probability theory, what does this mean? That my system and bath are uncorrelated. And we'll see, we'll use this all the time. This comes back and comes back. So it means that what happens here is completely independent of what happens in the outside world. If we think from a point of view of probability, if I have Pi, the probability of the system, and I have Pj, probability of my states in the bath. So I can think about my combined probability will be Pi times Pj. And if I want to know what's Pi, I sum over this, Pi times Pj, and I sum over J. I can take this outside, and the sum of Pj is 1, so I get what I had before. So, if I look at this, and I want to know this is the combined state of the system and bath, and I want to know what's or is, the equivalent would be to take the trace over the bath of rho sb, which would become just this. So if they're uncorrelated, there's no relation in probability, and the state of the system is independent of what the path is doing. So this is an important, in a way, very important point, because we're going to use it also as an approximation. So now I use it as an exact expression. We say our system and path are uncorrelated. In this case, it means I can look only at my systems. I can do local measurements on my systems, and I have all the information that I want in the world. I don't have to care about the rest of the world. Now, it's as customary to use this as an initial condition. If it's justified or not, wait, it's not always justified. But let's say you agree that at some time my system and bath didn't touch each other, I put them in contact at some time t equals zero. So this is where I'm going to start. So if I want to know what's at time t, I use my u and u dag. These are my rules that I describe the evolution of my combined density operator at time t, and I can write it u or s of time 0 like that. But this is not what I want. What I want is this. So I can write that my system at time t is a trace over the bath of u rho s rho b u dagger. And I think I didn't forget anything. It's like that. Now this u is the combined evolution of both. Okay, so this gives me formally correct statement about the system. But this is not what I want. What I want is what's called a reduced description. I want to know how the state of my system evolves only using operators from my system, without direct reference to the outer world. So I want to know how this evolves, and in some way I want to get rid of this part, this, and to minimize this in a way that I can talk only on my system and look at this part and treat this part, I know it exists, but implicitly. So you can say here I have everything explicit. I showed you everything. Everything that's happening is written here. What I want is equations of motion which only treat my system, which are what's called the explicit for my system, implicit for the outer world. So I don't want them to have them directly. I want to have only their influence on my system. So the question is, how can I make progress from this statement, which is always correct, at least for my initial state that I chose, to something that looks more like the bath? And here comes an important result that I'll write it here, which is due to Krauss, that this is always, you can write this as the following. And so Krauss, in I think in about 1960, 1960, and this is the only, he got his fame by one paper. So you see, some people have to write many papers, and Carlson wrote, in a way, maybe it was even a PhD thesis. He wrote this expression, which it's a few lines to go from here to here. I'm not doing it now, but it would be a nice exercise for you to go with this. The other thing that I didn't tell you, that this part, kj times kj dagger, the sum over all of them is the identity. So Krauss told us that any type of evolution like this, which I started from this tensor product, uncorrelated initial state, you can always write it in this form. There is some operator k, your state at time zero, it's conjugate operator k dagger, and this you can always write it like that, and you have this condition that this is one. Now, I know this is a, so I'm not going to go through this mathematics. It looks a little bit strange at first sight, but if you think about it as an example, this is an example of Gauss. Here, our sum has only one operator, u, and u times u dagger is the identity. So this is already Gauss form. So if you want to think, okay, how can I generate a Gauss form, just without which obeys this type of equation of motion. Let's say I have a dice and I throw it, and if I get, I have two coins, better instead of dice, I won't count. So I have a coin, I don't have any coins, sorry. I throw it, one side I choose unitary operator number one, the other side I choose unitary operator number two. So I have two choices of my evolution, and I want to know what would be the average evolution if I combine once like that, once like that. So I say in this case, my Gauss operator would be in a, let's say u. K1 would be u1, but I need to one of it, I need them to sum. Okay, we'll do that. Let's say K2 would be u2. And these are two. So then, what we need, since we need these to be normalized, so we know u1 times u1 dagger is identity, and u2 times u2 dagger is identity. So in order to renormalize it, I have to put 1 over the square root of 2 on each one of them. And I generated, as an example, a Gauss-type evolution out of this random choice between two types of unitaries. I put this just an example that this, I didn't bring this completely from outer space. If we know these rules, we can generate different types of stochastic evolutions as we wish. We just have to put them in this type of form. Now, Gauss got it from this evolution. So in this case, you can always write evolution of this structure system, interface bath, as Gauss operators. So you can always write this like that.
You assume that rho sp is the tensor product in this Gauss form?
You have to assume that this is a very important point.
It's to me, it is quite obvious then. Yeah. It has to be that way. Because what does the time evolution do to a very limited form of the density operator in this case? It just, rho s and rho v are individual density matrices, and a matrix has a base. So it can only change the eigenbase of the matrix. That's what the time evolution can do. But in the Hilbert space, eigenbase is a direction. So it changes the direction by changing the principal axis of a moment of inertia matrix, for instance. So in that case, it looks like the evolution can only change the direction of the matrix, eigenvalues of the matrix, and that's what the cross one.
Yeah, but you could say this direction depends on this. You could say these, in this case, the cross operators depend
yes.
On the state of the bath at time zero.
Yes, but in the cross form, it is an assumption. You don't need to prove that.
No, you have to have this assumption.
Yes. Yes.
If you don't have this assumption, it's not.
That assumption. Assumption is very difficult to prove. Probably. It's not.
Yeah. Okay, but that's what's the fun of doing axiomatic theory. I put my axiomatic theory. I said, okay, my evolution is going to be like that. And then we always have to do what I call a reality check. Are our assumptions correct to the physical world? And sometimes yes, sometimes no. But we have to do a certain idealizations to continue. And this idealization, thermodynamically, is very crucial. Because this idealization, which we'll see, we keep at every instant, not only at t equal zero. We'll do this all as an assumption or consequence. We'll use this all the time. Mean that I can measure my system independent of the bath. So it means that if I want to know what are my local observables, I can measure my system only and I can forget about the bath, if this is correct. Otherwise, if I do a measurement, it depends on the bath state. And it's not that this is not correct, but it's not what we want to do in thermodynamics. We want to, in thermodynamics, we say, you can say we want extensive variables, which means we can measure here, and we can add the energy here to the energy here, and we can partition, which, in a way, this partitioning of a thermodynamical state basically imposes this. So we can say this is an idealization. Now I'm only going to use it at t equals zero, but when we'll do some go on, we'll see that as an approximation, we're going to use this for every time, not only at t equals zero, which is what happens in the theory of open quantum systems, and is not written explicitly. That's why I put it, because in theory, when we'll reach Lindblad forms, this is correct at all times, but they don't tell you that. They cheat, but they don't tell. So I try to cheat and tell you. So you'll know the limitations of what we're doing. Yeah, should we stop now, or what's the time?
So if it's okay for you, we can have a break, coffee break, and
yeah.
Then we can have a unified long session too, till the lunch.
Okay.
After the coffee break.
Yeah.
If it's
okay. For me it's fine. Yeah. So maybe.